I'm Michael Holden, director of Park Place Gallery. The show is Vanitas by Peter Schenck. Peter has shown internationally in London, Paris, Canada, Italy, Manhattan at Freight and Volume. He's curated for the last 8 years. He went to school at University of Pennsylvania for graduate school, undergraduate at Boston University. So Peter, Vanitas, tell me why you chose Vanitas as the title of the exhibition.
Sure, good question, Michael, and good to be here. It seemed like a nice, straightforward title for the subject matter I was dealing with. Vanitas, if new to the viewer, don't know what that means. It's essentially, it could probably be connected with a lot of things, but it's connected with the subject of 16th century Dutch still life, and that still life could have rotting fruit in it. It could have a skull. It could have like a chalice where liquid is pouring out. And all those elements, while they're still life elements too, it's a connection with the temporality of life, and that time is going, and pleasures and vices exist, and they're a part of our lives. But it's a reminder that life is gonna have a finite ending to it. So that's, you know, and a fair amount is not always the greatest to hear, but it was a subject in still life painting that I always found interesting and like thought-provoking, and also interesting that I think still life too, for a big swath of history, was sort of second to big like portraiture and history painting and blah blah blah. But getting past that, and essentially this sort of emblem for the finite quality of life, and that death is you know, at some point we will, all of us will meet. I like the idea of that being an overarching theme for the subjects in this show, and connections are, there's a mixture in all of these paintings. While there is a fair amount of portraiture, it's portraiture meeting still life, and within still life, I do have skulls in my painting, like that connection with Vanitas as a historical thing. Plants and these temporal things that will come and go in our lifetime are in my paintings. While I might not have a 16th century goblet, I have, you know, a PBR bottle like spilling out. And that's both a very intimate connection, because I'll drink PBR, I like to drink beer, but that's my kind of like personal connection of like this temporality and things like that. And then coupled with that is what I want to bring my own stuff, is like my personal journey as a painter. And it's a lot of straightforward stuff that other painters use, but coupling Vanitas with my paintbrush that has oozing paint dripping out of it, or a palette. All of these kind of like tools, constructive things, things that are connected with vice, being like food or beer, but things that while they're static in paintings, things are flowing and oozing and time is going. So there's an answer for now, but
So this year is 2022. The work dates back to 2020. And your last solo show at Freight and Volume, you deal with humor a lot in your work. This, in some ways, there still is some dark humor and some humorous gestures in the work, but it has a more serious, more serious look at the Vanitas, or the mapping of life. And it is that. So tell us a little bit about going through COVID.
Yeah.
And I know you had a studio change.
Yeah.
And so just on a personal level, I think everyone's had to kind of deal with this time in a way, and it's being reflected, I feel, in this work.
Yeah.
So you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah. I'll see how I can put it. Yeah, it was a commingling of those things, right? So as a jumping off point, like moving from that, my last big kind of presentation, certainly in New York, was 2018 show titled Comedy Cellar at Frame Volume, a guy I was involved with and had two really strong shows that I'm proud of. And while there was like pathos and little glimmers of like darker imagery, they were essentially these lighter paintings where the title itself, and then as a jumping off point, Comedy Cellar was about and centered around a short period of time where I was a stand-up comedian. And I would say experimenting with trying to just be as an experience, go to open mics and stuff like that as a comedy experience, as maybe an experience I would then take into my paintings, which I did. And in a nutshell, those paintings were, even if it was like a bulbous kind of made up figure or a pizza head or more of like a amorphic kind of humorous monster, it was a figure with the tropes of being a stand-up comedian where there's a brick wall and there's a light source. So there were some of these elements, but it was a lot lighter in tone. Literally the name itself, with Cellar being a little bit of a darker connotation, was a lighter humor show. And that's been my work to a certain extent from, say, 2009, 2010, when I got out of grad school at UPenn. But fast forwarding to this work, which essentially, as Michael said, like the core of it was begun in 2020. There were a handful of paintings that were begun in 2019, but the core of them were all finished and finalized really during the crux of at least the first 2 years of the pandemic we're in. So, right, a few things happen, and there'll probably be a panning shot. I did, like, while skulls and things had maybe been a part of a handful of paintings, I decided to sort of focus on them on these kind of small format canvases and works on paper. And I began these like very like kind of more intimate skull paintings right around April and May, when we were about 2 or 3 months into the pandemic. And if I can sort of like frame it, it wasn't like, oh, look at me and I'm making a painting about death and pandemic. But in my own way, I was trying to have a connection where without trying too hard, my humor was coming through them. I wanted these skulls to maybe have a smirk or be looking back at the viewer with some level of life. But on a certain reality, and things are still crazy, there's still no level of normalcy, just varying new normalcy. It was grappling with, I think, what we all had, and particularly in New York, a very real sense that death was around every corner. It was like right there, palpable. I also had a good friend that was battling cancer at the time. So these things were on my mind while I was painting it. And that was like, I think that was a turning point into that. And then coupled with that palpable sense of death and just the utter strangeness of COVID, right around that same time, a couple months into the pandemic, middle of 2020, I essentially left a much more communal studio with two other artists. Even though we had partitions, we, like a lot of artists, a lot of people, we had to basically tear down that space. It just wasn't feasible. And I moved to a home studio in my apartment in Crown Heights, Brooklyn, from where I had been not far from here in Bushwick. And initially I was like pretty bummed out that I was like, oh, I hadn't worked from home in some time. But it became this kind of flowering, if you will, of like a newfound intimacy with my work, because even in the past studio had my own space, but you know, there was chatter, there was other artists, and it was a great experience. But it came to an end at maybe, if we hadn't planned it, but an interesting moment in my work. And I think that coupled with this sort of palpability of death, but that I still had a lot of humor and life in my work, it a lot of these paintings, and I think for the better, became more intimate to the studio instead of, I'm not on the comedy cellar floorboards anymore. As much as I hope they're universal images, they became like, while it changed guises, this bulbous head or this figure that was me in a room alone with my paintbrush, with my palette, and that just kind of started flooding in more.
Cool. So Red Eye, there's a lot of, I feel, gaming going on in this, mm-hmm. and this interpretation of a self-portrait, you are what you eat kind of thing. Everything's in it.
Yeah.
The figure being a central part of the face, and then this eyeball, mm-hmm. and the eye dazzling play of color.
Yeah.
Tell me how you interpret that as a reference to self-portrait, or?
Yeah, I mean, so I think it was my way. I mean, I like to throw a lot into most of my paintings, and it, you know, it keeps me entertained and busy in the studio. But with this particular painting, Red Eye, it was like, you know, I don't think at the very beginning I set out, but I almost, once I got into the painting or number of weeks and it came from a sketch, it was like, I want to shoot for like a summation kind of paintings of what are my ideas. Like, and to me, it is a really nice bridge painting of, I can have still life in there. I can have a very totemic frontal face looking at you. I can have all my artist tools and all that stuff. But yeah, you mentioned the word like gaming. There's, you know, while obviously it's a painting at the end of the day, there's a lot of like, you know, there's a mixture of kinetic activity with these, you know, humorous circles or balls, if you will, floating around this central figure. There's a rather large eyeball in the bottom of the composition. It swirls around to the very tightly rendered polka dots, or the dots that are the color on the palette.
This painting was painted before that painting, right?
Yeah, it's funny. Well, this painting was started in summer 2019. I finished it after that painting.
You started that one after.
Right. So that painting is a totally, except for a few moves, but let's just call it an encapsulated painting in the year that is 2020.
Right.
I began it in whatever, May of 2020. I concluded it in December of 2020. This I began in summer 2019. I finished it at a given state of what I consider finished fall of 2021.
Yeah.
But that painting rests inside this, and that was like, and certainly the imagery on a certain fluidity was something that's connected with that painting where this was started, whatever, after that.
Well, so. It's funny because this one is very active, very playful, very dynamic.
Yeah.
But there's also something somewhat stiff about it and rigid.
Yeah, totally.
You know, where like that one is not rigid at all.
Right.
You know?
Right. This is a mixture of like, while there's curves, there's still like 60, 70 hard, you know, angular lines.
Right.
That's,
but I feel like you had to paint this.
Yeah.
To paint that, because that one, I think you could just automatically express yourself.
Yeah.
Right.
So I mean, it's interesting that this painting, while begun in 2019 and pre-pandemic, I wanted to make it work, but it shows in that very, it's an extremely front, like angular thing. It was what I had been doing to a certain extent in terms of like angles from other paintings previous. And that painting, or as I titled, The Skull Finds the Heart, that was done in like the craziest year in my lifetime, and in 2020,
right.
Where I finally allowed myself to be like, there might be a hard line or one or two in this, but this is going to be by almost nature of the times we're living in, and fluidity and weirdness, and nothing is normal anymore. That finally, that gave or birthed that, or I should also say 2020 birthed The Skull Finds a Heart.
But there's all these relationships that give this overall mood that, that I feel is interesting on an abstract level, that the mood is articulated throughout, consistently throughout the whole.
Because I think we were talking in a previous conversation of de Kooning and a few anchor points where there was a mouth or eyes, and I got the angles of those eyes I picked out from just like a small de Kooning drawing where he would use them, but that he could show, and you coined it pretty well, he could show in like exhaustion and that feeling with just the slant of eyes. And I think, and it was part of that year, but as a its own painting, I was like, well, yeah, there's an anchor point right there. And then I can have this kitchen sink approach to forms, whether hands or maybe hanging meat or leaves or all that, but I'm gonna come back to those anchor points of the eyes and the tiredness in the eyes. And if I can, as a goal, make those forms expand upon that futility or that exhaustion kind of thing.
Well, also it seems like your symbols or even your palette, not of all the works in this show, but there is this palette that symbolically represents color as far as flesh, water, light source, greenery, plant life forms, and eyes or mouth or breast or hands, palettes, beer bottles. But these things are repeated throughout this body of work in different contexts, and are just enough information to articulate easily. But then when they're juxtaposed within the greater image, you're thrown off, and there's a lot of mystery.
Right.
How do you feel about that relationship with the your symbols, whether it's color or form or the meaning of form?
Yeah.
And then this kind of mystery of the greater composition.
Yeah. No. It's without it being cliched, it's an ongoing question that I'm trying to answer in the paint, and that's what kept me interested in the first place with that, because that's definitely a new departure where I might have mysterious forms, but I might, like, the body of work that preceded this was like those forms kind of had they were a little bit more easily defined, or they might, or might be a rubber duck or like a paintbrush, but they all had their place in the canvas with a little bit more room around them. And with these, I was interested in a lot of questions, and not all of them have been answered, but I gave myself, I guess, a certain amount of bandwidth or whatever to have these things jostling around. But going back to like use of color, where I'd also like to screw around with it a bit, color could be an anchor point for me. I could have the fleshy pinks, or I could have the green of the leaf, and then maybe go on a tangent of more like decaying color that could be this for the meat. And so those were anchor points, while something with the skull finds the heart, there's things that I could hang my like hat on and be like, there are the eyes. But I gave myself more room with, to be honest, more questions, if that answers the question at all, of these more amorphous shapes that are a thing you could maybe name, but maybe not. And I guess I was more or less more comfortable for the first time of having more of that mystery and being okay with it.
So you're, in some ways, you're providing answers that that generate a question.
Yeah, that's probably pretty apt. Or I mean,
do you feel like resolving a painting is creating an answer, or do you feel like it's creating a question?
I think, I mean, to me, and probably the, like what we all would want, I mean, questions are probably a lot more interesting than answers, but And I think the people that we've had come through this exhibition and see it, whether if it's colleagues, friends, but the person on the street that comes in, I think a word that has come up, which I don't think should be a bad word, is like accessibility. I want a certain amount of accessibility in these paintings. I'd like an aim with a lot of these works, if it's a pencil, if it's a brush, if it's an eyeball, someone where there's like a safety net for someone to get into. And then once they're into this strange Schenck world, then I want to push them of what their belief of abstraction could be, or just ideas about color, or, you know, in certain paintings, male, female parts joining because it's a painting and whatever, or like animal parts, or, you know, even if they're ambiguous, is that an organ? Is that like organ meat? Is that like an insect? And that's where I want the mystery to kind of flood in a bit. But I also, and then I want it to boomerang back on, like, there's a beer bottle, there's a palette. So I want a few things answered, and then I want a lot of questions. Yeah.
Well, I think you've given us a lot to think about here. Beautifully orchestrated. Come see this show, Vanitas, by Peter Schenck. At Two Suns is a space, Park Place is a gallery. Michael Holden's the curator. We look forward to having you view it. Hey,